Господин генерален секретар на НАТО, господин министър на отбраната, Ваше Величество, господин президент Желев, господин президент Стоянов, Ваши превъзходителства, господин председател на Европейския съюз, испанския посланник господин Фуентес, министри, депутати, евродепутати, уважаеми студенти, ученици, младежи и любими спонсори. Пред нас има един политик с забележителна европейска кариера, която той започва още през далечната 1974 година като председател на либералната младеж в Дания. И се издига до министър-председател на Дания. Той е един от най-успешните министър-председатели в целия Европейски съюз в периода между 2001 и 2009 година. През 2009 той беше избран като 12-тия генерален секретар на НАТО и заедно със себе си донесе вятъра на промяната в организацията. Само една илюстрация искам да дам, за да не правя дълго презентация, вие имате неговата биография. Усилията на генералния секретар на НАТО направиха така, че войски на НАТО маршируваха на 9 май на Червения площад по повод Деня на победата. Смятам, че това беше едно забележително постижение, в което лично генералният секретар на НАТО Андерс Фок Расмусен има принос. Между 2001 и 2009 година аз лично съм имал възможност много пъти да се срещам с него, било то по правителствена или по либерална линия, или пък да участвам в негови срещи с тогавашния министър-председател Симеон Сакскобургготски. Сега може би е момента да споделя с вас една тайна. През 2002 година, втората половина на годината, Дания беше председател на Европейския съюз. Тогава все още не се знаеше дали България ще получи дата за членство, дали тази година или дата ще бъде 2009, дали ще е 2013, имаше и такива предложения, или пък ще бъде 2007, както настояваше правителството. Тогавашният министър-председател на Дания ни каза: какво можем да направим, а пък нашия министър-председател го чу и го разбра какво трябва да направим, в резултат на което през октомври месец годината 2007 се появи като че ли изневиделица. Искам специално да благодаря на генералния секретар Андерс Фок Расмусен и да ви помоля да се присъедините към мен да го приветстваме.
President Pathy, former heads of state and government, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me first of all thank the Atlantic Club of Bulgaria, the Open Society Institute and the Central Military Club for hosting this event. I am so delighted to be here today to meet so many good friends and to share with you my views on NATO's future. And let me begin with a quote by Ilias Canetti, the Nobel Prize winning author who was born here in Bulgaria. He once said that it does not matter how new an idea is. What matters is how new it becomes. And one can hardly find a better description of NATO and the transatlantic security community. The idea of an Atlantic alliance is now more than 60 years old, and yet the idea becomes new time and time again, because our alliance continues to transform. And my message to you here today is that we must not only continue this transformation, we must accelerate it. When the Washington Treaty was signed in April 1949, It created a new partnership between North America and Western Europe with a pledge of mutual defense at its core. Yet common fear was not the main motivating principle for this unique alliance. The true inspiration was a common democratic ethos. From its very beginning, the Atlantic Alliance was not only about protecting territory, it was also about preserving our democratic values. NATO was a new type of partnership, unlike the shifting alliances of convenience, which has brought so much tragedy upon Europe. NATO was permanent. It was democratic, and it was transatlantic. In short, NATO was unlike any other alliance in the past. And this explains why the end of the Cold War did not mean the end of NATO. It only meant the end of the first chapter of NATO's evolution. With the crumbling of the Berlin Wall and the Iron Curtain, we were able to start writing the second chapter of NATO, the consolidation of Europe as an undivided democratic security space. This second chapter saw our transatlantic community reach out to the whole of Europe. It saw the creation of the Euro-Atlantic Partnership Council, the Partnership for Peace, and the Mediterranean Dialogue. It saw the evolution of a new relationship with Russia and Ukraine, and it saw the historic success of our open door policy, a success that manifested itself in the accession of many new members, including, of course, Bulgaria in 2004. The post-Cold War chapter of NATO also saw the alliance acting militarily, first as a peacekeeper in Bosnia, then as a peace enforcer in Kosovo. These challenging missions were not about immediate self-defense. They were about defending our core values and about protecting a region at the very heart of Europe from sliding back into darkness and chaos. The transatlantic community succeeded because we combined power and purpose. And if this entire region is on its way back into the European mainstream today, it is because the transatlantic community was willing to take responsibility and risks at a crucial juncture in Europe's history. To come back to Elias Canetti's observation, by the time the Cold War ended, the idea of a transatlantic community was certainly no longer new, but by applying it to all of Europe and by creating new policies and new mechanisms to expand democracy, security, and integration across the entire continent, the idea of a transatlantic community was renewed. Today, the transatlantic community is once again faced with the challenge of transformation. We have to understand that security today is no longer just about security for Europe and in Europe. In the age of globalization, our security is no longer determined by geography. The terrorist attacks of the 11th of September 2001 demonstrated that our security can be affected by developments halfway around the globe. Terrorism, failing states, and the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction have security implications that reach far beyond the region in which they originate. We either tackle these problems where they emerge, or they will end up at our doorstep. Absorbing this lesson and adapting NATO accordingly is the greatest challenge for our alliance since its creation over 60 years ago. But in Afghanistan today, NATO's most demanding mission ever, we are demonstrating our strong determination to meet this challenge. If we were to allow this country to become again a safe haven for terrorists, instability would spread throughout Central Asia, and it would only be a matter of time until that instability would spread to the Black Sea region too. Like its NATO allies, Bulgaria fully understands this. It also understands that we must do more in Afghanistan now in order to do less later. ISAF, the international coalition, will continue to grow in strength this year. More and more nations are joining the mission. 46 countries are now participating. I want to use this opportunity to thank Bulgaria for its valuable contribution to our ISAF mission. Despite many challenges, Bulgaria has not lessened its efforts, and I welcome its intention to even increase its contribution in the coming months. Together, we will protect the population and pull the rug from under the insurgency. We will then start to transfer additional security responsibilities to the Afghan forces themselves, district by district, province by province. And as the effectiveness and strength of the Afghan army and police grow, ISAF will reduce its own security operations and focus more on support and training of the Afghans. Ladies and gentlemen, Afghanistan will remain our number one operational priority for a long time to come. But if we want NATO to remain as successful in the future as it was in the past, we also have to look beyond Afghanistan and to aim for a thorough transformation of our alliance, both in terms of its policies and its capabilities. What does such a thorough transformation of NATO entail? Let me offer a few pointers. First, we must rejuvenate NATO as a place for frank and forward-looking discussion on new security developments. Of course, NATO should be more than a mere talking shop. But it should also be more than a management tool to run operations. We should broaden and intensify our political debate. We need to constantly scan the strategic horizon in order to be better prepared for what the future may bring. And whenever any ally feels threatened. We should make more active use of consultations under Article 4 of the NATO Treaty to consider if and how we should respond. Second, we must continue to transform our military capabilities. This means investing in more deployable and usable forces, and reviewing the way we plan and fund our operations. But it also means thoroughly examining new ways of defending against new threats. One key element of any effective defense is the defense against missiles. In the Cold War, many people thought of missile defense as destabilizing. They argued that defenses might upset the mutual deterrence relationship between the superpowers. Today, however, over 30 countries have or are developing missile capabilities with greater and greater ranges. In many cases, these missiles could eventually threaten our populations and our territories, and several countries are seeking nuclear weapons, and this is a deadly combination. Iran is a case in point. Statements from Iranian officials declare the range of their modified Shahab 3 missiles to be 2,000 kilometers. That will already put allied countries within reach: Turkey, Greece, Romania, and Bulgaria. That's why I believe that the time has come for us to move ahead and make missile defense a genuine alliance mission. This is my target for the next NATO summit in Lisbon in November. The United States already has a missile defense system. Some European allies have a capacity to protect deployed forces against missile attacks. But of course, we must also be able to protect our populations, all of our populations. If we connect national systems into a NATO-wide missile shield to protect all our allies, that would be a very powerful demonstration of NATO solidarity in the 21st century. And it can be even more. It can be a catalyst for a new dynamic in European and Euro-Atlantic security. How? By cooperating with Russia. I'm aware that Russia's current views on missile defense range from hostile to ambivalent, and I'm also aware that there are technical hurdles that would have to be overcome in linking up our systems. But I do not believe these obstacles are insurmountable. Once Russia starts to feel the effects of proliferation on her, I am sure she will begin to see missile defense as an opportunity rather than a threat. And what may look like a daring proposal today may soon turn into a mainstream view. One security roof that we build together, that we support together, and that protects us all by linking up our systems. My third point: we must develop closer relations with civilian actors. Today's security challenges cannot be met with military means alone. Afghanistan shows this very clearly. Military force can buy time, time to launch political reconciliation, to rebuild infrastructure, and jumpstart the economy. These tasks, however, are the responsibility of civilian actors. That is why we need a coordinated approach, a true comprehensive approach that links NATO with the other international civilian actors, notably the United Nations, the European Union, and the NGO community. Bringing such diverse actors together is difficult, but it is the key to security in this century. Fourth, we must expand our partnerships to enhance our ability to deal with global challenges. Whether Australia or New Zealand, whether Japan or the Republic of Korea, we need to cooperate with partners from across the globe. The logic of globalization demands nothing less. Indeed, I predict that in just a few years' time, it will become completely natural for us to discuss global security issues with China, India, and other major powers. Fifth, we need a unified NATO approach to deal with new non-traditional security challenges. One of these challenges is cyber defense. Our ally, Estonia, suffered a massive cyber attack a few years ago, and I can tell you that our NATO headquarters is attacked about 100 times each day. Clearly, cyber attacks have become a new form of permanent low-level warfare, and we must be prepared to counter this threat. Effective cyber defense requires the means to prevent, detect, respond to, and recover from attacks. We have started to address all these dimensions, but we need to do even better, because the next major attack on our alliance may well come down a fiber optic cable. Another non-traditional security challenge is energy security. And I know that is a particular concern here in Bulgaria. Your country has experienced the impact of an energy cutoff several times. You know that it can severely disrupt a country's economic and social fabric. Clearly, this is not just a political and economic challenge. It is also a security challenge. And this makes energy security a legitimate subject for NATO. Of course, energy security is a complex issue that involves producers, consumers, and transit countries. That's why a one-size-fits-all approach will not work. But we need to develop a better understanding of the security dimension. We must intensify our relations with energy-producing countries, and we must also develop our means to protect critical energy infrastructure and to mitigate the effects of accidents. At NATO headquarters in Brussels, we have just set up a new division on emerging security challenges. A new division that will become operational in August. It will deal with, amongst other things, terrorism, proliferation, cyber defense, and energy security. And it will support a much more focused, regular and open debate among the Allies on these vital issues. And then my last point in this list of transformation issues. We must continue our European consolidation agenda. This task is not yet complete. It will only be complete once all countries in Europe are where they want to be. And once Russia, our largest neighbor, has also found her rightful place in our continent's new architecture. NATO's open door policy will remain part and parcel of this agenda, as will be our policy of constructively engaging Russia. Ladies and gentlemen, taken together, all this makes for a most demanding transformation agenda. That is why the work on our new strategic concept for NATO has attracted so much interest. A new document will facilitate this transformation by defining the alliance core tasks and strategies. Just a few days ago, Madeleine Albright and her group of experts published their analysis and recommendations on NATO's future. It is a solid piece of work, and it will help me to prepare my own first draft of the new strategic concept. The process is well on track, and I'm more optimistic than ever that our Lisbon summit in November will produce a truly innovative document. Ladies and gentlemen, the idea of transatlantic security community is now over 6 decades old. And yet it remains a tremendously attractive notion. We may talk a lot today about rising powers, about the emergence of new economic centers of gravity. All true, but the partnership between North America and Europe will remain unique. North America and Europe will remain the world's strongest community of like-minded nations. Democratic, outward-looking, and with a sense of global responsibility. No other community of nations can generate such a powerful, positive momentum. And no other community is as attractive to others who want to help shoulder the burden of common security. NATO remains the institutional foundation for this community. By continuing NATO's transformation, we will ensure that our alliance remains fit for purpose and that we can look to the future with confidence. Thank you very much.
Благодаря, господин генерален секретар. Смятам, че успяхме да се уверим в забележителната визия, която генералният секретар на НАТО има за развитието на нашата организация през следващите години. И съм убеден, че тази негова визия ще получи пълна материализация по време на Лисабонския съмит на НАТО през ноември тази година. Пожелавам ви наистина да реализирате и материализирате тази визия, защото Алиансът се нуждае от нея. Специално искам да отбележа, че В залата имаме над 1000 човека, аз очаквах някъде 200-300 човека, но такава посещавана лекция не сме имали. И очевидно интереса както към генералния секретар, така и към темата, така и към НАТО в България се засилва. Искам специално да благодаря на министъра на външните работи и на министъра на отбраната, които ни подпомогнаха за организацията на тази лекция, а министъра на отбраната пък ни даде тази прекрасна зала, която, за съжаление, също се оказва тясна. Генералният секретар имаше интерес да общува с българските младежи, студенти, така че те сега ще имат възможност да му зададат въпроси. Той каза, готов съм да говоря по-кратко, но да отговарям малко повече на ваши въпроси. Така че, уважаеми млади приятели, вие сте на ход. Заповядайте. Това не означава, че и някой по-възрастен човек не може да зададе въпрос. След лекцията ще има и малък коктейл, може да се качите горе. Има ли... Тук виждаме една студентска ръка. Заповядайте.
Добър ден. Дойчин Котоаров съм, Софийския университет.
По-силно.
Дойчин Котоаров, Софийския университет. Уважаеми господин генерален секретар, въпросът ми е относно участието на НАТО в охранителните дейности за гарантиране на безопасното корабоплаване в Аденския залив. И не смятате ли, че е крайно време НАТО да вземе водеща координационна роля по този проблем? Благодаря.
Благодаря.
As you know, NATO is already engaged actively in counter-piracy along the coast of Somalia. We have our own operation. We cooperate with other actors, among them the European Union and also individual nations. We will continue this operation and actually, though they are still attacks by pirates, we have been quite successful in preventing hijacking and attacks from pirates. But obviously the situation still requires our presence and we will continue our operation.
Благодаря ви. Заповядайте.
Гергана Йорданова, Военна академия Раковски, магистърска програма Национална сигурност. Господин генерален секретар, в своето изказване вие благодарихте за участието на България в мисията ISAF в Афганистан. Бих искала да ви попитам какво допълнително очаква Алианса от държавите партньорки в тази мисия. Благодаря.
Right now, we have a strong focus on our training mission in Afghanistan. I have also discussed this with the Minister of Defense and other ministers today. We appreciate the Bulgarian decision to increase the Bulgarian contribution to our mission. And from an overall perspective, we have been quite successful in our fourth generation. We will increase the number of troops in Afghanistan by almost 40,000 during 2010. However, we have still some shortfalls as regards our training mission. Small numbers, but still critical shortfalls. And this is the reason why I travel around and I urge all allies to look closer into the possibilities to provide more trainers for our training mission. I mean, people in our in troop contributing countries expect us to provide the conditions for a gradual transition to Afghan lead. We will stay in Afghanistan until we have finished our job. But obviously this is not forever. We want to hand over the responsibility to the Afghans, but we can't do that until they have the capacity to take responsibility themselves. Therefore, our training mission is the key to fulfill our goal of transition to Afghan leadership. And this is the reason why I urge nations to look once more if they could find some
additional trainers to our training mission.
Благодаря ви. И на правостоящите да дадем възможност.
Даниела Стоева, студент по право. Уважаеми господин генерален секретар, моят въпрос е следният. Имам чувството, че България не е достатъчно добре представена сред служителите в НАТО и има позиции като тази на заместник генерален секретар, които от 1971 година до сега се заемат от представители на страната Италия. Същевременно от тогава до сега страните членки са се увеличили от 16 тогава до 28 в момента. Не смятате ли, че това е малко демотивиращо за останалите страни членки? Благодаря.
It's a relevant question, and I can inform you that we have now introduced a new system. Appointments to posts in the international staff will take place based on qualifications and merits. So when people apply for a specific position in our international staff, they will go through tests and eventually our decision will be based on the outcome of these tests on merits and qualifications. And we have also decided that the overall goal should be a better distribution of posts between all allies. So we have to balance between these two considerations. On the one hand, qualifications must be given the highest priority. And on the other hand, we also have to make sure that there is a better distribution of posts than today. So my intention is to make sure that we get the best qualified people wherever they might come from.
Чудесно. И Даниела, може да се кандидатираш вече. Аз искам специална благодарност да отправя към генералния секретар на НАТО, Андерс Фог Расмусен, за това, че той продължи близо 20 годишната традиция на генерални секретари да се обръщат към Атлантическия клуб. Ние наистина влезахме в 20-та си годишнина, която ще отбележим през април до година. И искам да използвам това, че генералният секретар е сред нас, за да ви покажа новото лого, с което ще отбележим 20 годишнината. Може да помоля за, на този екран да се появи логото? А на генералния секретар... Не, чакайте сега, това с... Не дейте, моля ви, за това са спонсорите. Това е Атлантическия клуб. То верно, че има съвпадение между Атлантическия клуб и спонсорите, но все пак това е. Специално искам да благодаря на професор Тодор Върджиев, който направи това лого. Професоре, бихте ли се изправили? Той е патриарх. Той е патриарх на българския шрифт и член на борда на Атлантическия клуб, поради което и цялата художествена академия подкрепя НАТО. И всъщност това е един, тъй като безплатно ни е направил логото, мога да кажа, че това е единственият професор, който е спонсор на Атлантическия клуб. Един малък принос бихме искали да направим по повод нашата 20 годишнина и в добавка към това, което групата на мъдреците под ръководството на госпожа Олбрайт предложи на генералния секретар за визия, да му предложа една малка концепция в 14 точки, които смятам, че могат да подпомогнат процеса на взимане на решение в това отношение в НАТО. Заповядайте, господин генерален секретар. Продължаваме с въпросите. Заповядайте тук от втория ред, след това третия ред.
Добър ден! Казвам се Росица Христова и съм студентка в Нов български университет, специалност национална и международна сигурност, магистърска програма. Бих искала да ви задам въпроса, господин генерален секретар. Аз лично вярвам, че програмата Партньорство за мир една от най-добрите ви инициативи. Бих искала да ви попитам за вашето мнение, кои са най-големите ви успехи от създаването на тази програма до сега. Благодаря.
I agree with you that the Partnership for Peace program has been and is very successful. No doubt that the Partnership for Peace program has constituted a efficient framework for reforms in the participating countries. And when you ask me what is the biggest success within the Partnership for Peace program, then I would say, without hesitation, that the biggest success was the enlargement of NATO, which eventually was the result of the Partnership for Peace process. So I would appoint that the biggest success. Having said that, we also have to be aware of the fact that not all participating Partnership for Peace countries have future membership as their ultimate goal, and we respect that. It is for each individual country to decide its alliance affiliation.
Получих един недвусмислен сигнал от протокола, че трябва към края да се придвижваме, за да не попречим на по-нататъчната програма на генералния секретар. Ще си позволя един кратък въпрос, нека да бъде заключителен. Той е за имиджа на НАТО. НАТО е международната организация, която вероятно има най-силен контраст между това, което е свършила, и това, което е нейния образ, между приноса и обществения рейтинг. НАТО вероятно заслужава Нобелова награда за мир и аз имах възможност да говоря по този въпрос с директора на Нобеловия комитет в дома на норвежката посланничка, която е сред нас. Искам да попитам генералния секретар какво той вижда като възможни инициативи и как ние, неправителствените организации, може да сме от полза за изграждане на един наистина забележителен имидж, който НАТО напълно заслужава.
Also a very relevant question, and the point of departure is quite good, I would say. I consider NATO the most, not only the most successful military alliance, defense alliance the world has ever seen, but actually I consider NATO the most successful peace movement the world has ever seen. During more than 60 years, we have succeeded in ensuring peace, stability, and paved the way for prosperity in the Euro-Atlantic area. And taking into consideration the situation in Europe after Second World War, that's quite an accomplishment. So, our point of departure is strong, I would say. Having said that, you're also right in pointing to the new challenge to convince new generations that NATO is just as necessary as in the past. I mean, young people who grew up after the wall fell and the Iron Curtain was abolished may not understand in the same way, at least, why NATO is so important. So I think, and that's part of my answer to your question, that an outreach to the young generation is of utmost importance. Non-governmental organizations can play a very strong role in that respect. I also think we should take advantage of new media to reach out to the younger generation. Personally, I use media like Facebook and Twitter and other means of communication to get in contact with people we might not otherwise address. So I think we should use a wide range of initiatives and instruments, but my main piece of advice would be for non-governmental organizations to step up their endeavors to include the younger generation in their work, because in the longer run, we cannot just rest on our laurels and point to NATO's indisputable historical success. We have to make clear to the young generation why NATO is also necessary in the future. And therefore, a dialogue with the young generation is of utmost importance, and you and non-governmental organizations can play a crucial role in that respect.
Много ви благодаря, специално за имиджа на НАТО в Европа. Може да предложим едно малко ноу-хау, ако то ще свърши работа на генералния секретар. И то е горе-долу следното. Ако това е емблемата на НАТО, а това е емблемата на Европейския съюз, може би по повод съмита може да направим една нова емблема, която да изглежда така. И всъщност, като се получи емблемата на Атлантическия клуб, НАТО ще се смени имиджа. Сега ми позволете да връча най-високото отличие на Атлантическия клуб на генералния секретар на НАТО. Впрочем, това е единственото отличие. Златната значка. Генералния секретар.